إنك لا تهدي من أحببت ولكن الله يهدي من يشاء
Assalamu alaikum, salam. My name is John Fontaine and welcome back to another episode of the Young Smirks podcast. Just before we begin, I'd just like to ask everyone who's watching, please go to the YouTube and subscribe and also set the notifications. We have many different episodes with different people, but today we have a very special guest. We have Dr. Muhammad Salah. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you, John, for having me.
How are you doing, Sheikh?
I'm doing great, alhamdulillah.
SubhanAllah.
Beautiful.
We're here.
Nice scenery.
Beautiful swimming pool.
Mashallah.
Inshallah, we can go for a dip later, inshallah.
After dinner.
I know, late yesterday you pushed me in the pool. It's already gone...
Don't remind me.
It's already gone viral. You know, I put it on your social media.
You did?
Yeah. Man, it's on Instagram. Everyone's seen you pushing me in the pool, so... You know, if you do that to someone, then you have to let me do it to you, right?
In your dreams.
So, Sheikh, subhanAllah, you know, I've been watching you for many years when I became a Muslim, subhanAllah. You're one of the speakers I used to watch. And I've benefited a lot from you. Jazakallah khair.
Jazana wa
iyyakum. And you've been active in Dawah for many years.
Alhamdulillah. And
subhanAllah, you've traveled the whole world. And I just want to speak a bit about your work today because you're known most of all, as far as I'm aware, for your work on Huda TV and especially the Ask Huda. And I just wanted to ask, how did this begin? Because it's been very beneficial, especially living in the West. Many people, they don't have access to scholars or sheikhs. And even the internet is quite a new phenomenon, really. So people, you know, a lot of people call into your show and you give them answers. So how did this all begin?
Well, it all started when I traveled to the States to get my PhD in something called pharmacognosy, which deals with the pharmacology and the medicinal plants. It's a combination of both. Then I used to lead the prayer in Ramadan and so on. And they asked me to give the khutbah. I used to give the khutbah since I was in high school, but in Arabic. And said, you give the khutbah? I was really scared. I said, yeah, I will give the khutbah in Arabic. They said, no, you give the khutbah in English. No one would understand you if you give it in Arabic, at least where I was. I said, look, I can speak for an hour about pharmacology, but not in khutbatul jumu'ah. So that was like an eye-opener to me. I said, yes, I was giving da'wah on a small scale to my colleagues. I used to have some Jewish colleagues, Christian colleagues. Alhamdulillah, shukrullah, it was working very well. But to the extent of giving khutbah, standing before the audience and without a paper, without a reference, and giving a speech and a public speech in English, it wasn't something that I expected that would happen one day. Mm. But subhanAllah, whenever Allah wants anything, He facilitates it. So I started preparing for it and started studying the religious terminology in English. Mm. And meanwhile, I enrolled in Al-Azhar again to get a degree in the Sharia, the Islamic law. The Al-Azhar has many schools. Mm. The finest school of college in Al-Azhar, as far as Islamic studies, is Kulliyat al-Sharia. Mm. So I was blessed to enroll in Kulliyat al-Sharia again. My wife has graduated already and she was doing her degree in the different dialects. So I decided to join her and study the different dialects of the Quran, since Inshallah. In order for her to learn, I used to sit with her. Mm. So I thought, let me get the same education and degree. But having good companions and good friends really changed my decision completely. So we were sitting once and they asked me, if you're living in the States, I was visiting Egypt. They said, if you're living in the States, we don't think the Americans will benefit much if you recite the 10 different dialects of the Quran. Mm. They may enjoy it, but it will not benefit them. Mm. I said, what do you mean? They said, you know, it's best if you study fiqh. Mm. People want to learn what is halal and what is haram because there are a lot of wrong fatwas here and there. Mm. So in the same setting, I changed the direction completely from studying the different dialects of the Quran into studying Islamic law and comparative fiqh. Mm. Alhamdulillah, it did work out very well. So I continued with the kuliyah and I graduated from Al-Azhar. He also finished my master's and PhD in the same field, alhamdulillah. Sure. And I almost forgot about my medical background.
SubhanAllah.
And I became full-time in da'wah more than 20 years ago, alhamdulillah wa shukrullah.
So I know Huda TV's been running for like 15 years now, right?
Yeah,
about 15 years.
Yeah.
So was you there from the beginning, or did you join later?
From day one. Alhamdulillah. From day one. From the we started Ramadan 2005. I was in the States, and they phoned me and they said, you know, in Ramadan, want to do a live show. I thought it's a crazy idea, and in Ramadan, I gotta lead the prayer and be in the community. You know, for so many years, I didn't go for Umrah during Ramadan because of my commitment of leading the prayer. But when you also make Mashura, you consult the people. I was even consulting my students and my colleagues. They said that's something much more beneficiary. So I let my brother lead the prayer. Then I presented the live show of Ask Huda for the first time in my life, Ramadan 2005.
Was you doing Q&A at that time? Was people phoning in, or was it more just
don't go there. I cannot tell you what happened to me. People do not know that. I sat and, you know, the director and the producer, everybody was trying to assure me, like you're sitting in the masjid and answering questions. And once I was live, you know, I was having cramps. And I felt like I'm going to die. And when the first phone started ringing, I was so scared that I wish I wasn't there. Then the question started one after another, non-stop.
Yeah.
And subhanAllah, I guess because of the frequency of the questions and the phone calls, I got distracted from the fear factor. So I just, I liked it. Alhamdulillah, shukrullah. And that led me to study more, to learn more, different madahib, because if you're sitting on that seat and answering people from different backgrounds, it is not fair to stick to one madhab and tell them this is how it is.
Yeah,
that's not fair.
Yeah, that's
you're catering for people from, you know, who are Hanafis, Shafi'is, Malikis, and following Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. You really have to study this, the one single mas'ala from all different angles.
I found that with your dawah, that you know you do take into consideration where the people are from, you know, what culture they're from, you know, because this
is very important.
It's so important.
It's very important. It's not fair to have a certain one mindset and try to impose it on people.
And certain communities that, like, of course, you've lived in the States, you've traveled all over the world. I live in England, and of course, the West is a mixture of different cultures and different understandings of Islam. But of course, if someone's phoning you from different parts of the world, they're just in one community, you know, and you have to take into consideration. And alhamdulillah, I've noticed that about your dawah.
Actually, living in North America or in Europe gives you the opportunity to have a small world in front of you, a bit in your hands. So in our community, you have like 15 to 17 different nationalities.
SubhanAllah.
Different mother tongues, different nationalities. Everybody was speaking English. Most of whom did not know Arabic and did not know how to read the Quran. But we started from the scratch. And mashallah, everybody has become professional in reading Quran.
How long did you live in the States for?
Between 17 to 20 years.
SubhanAllah. Basically, Sheikh, you don't look old enough.
Thank you. Alhamdulillah wa shukrullah. But basically, you know, the last few years I was going back and forth. So I wanted to keep running Huda TV and presenting the live show. It was only twice a week in the beginning. So this is all I have to do in addition to teaching at the university, Al-Azhar University, and also online London College. Then later on we started the Islamic University of North America. I was there since the beginning. So I was busy with the online teaching. With Al-Azhar, then the TV. Other TV stations like Iqra International in English and French, they signed a contract with me. So I was actually presenting. It wasn't like signing a contract, literally. It was an agreement.
Yeah.
So for, I was presenting, again, the live Fatawa program. And I've done a few other programs for them. PSTV. I've done a few programs for them.
Of course, yeah.
Islam Channel, every time I go to the UK, they host me for the live Q&A questions.
Sheikh, you know, subhanAllah, you've been invited all over the world. You've spent a lot of time in the Far East, the Middle East, you know, all over the world, subhanAllah. You've seen so much.
You know, when we started Huda TV, and I wanted to keep up with my work in the States and the conferences and the students, you're not going to believe that. You know, it takes you 12 hours direct flight from Cairo to JFK, New York City. 12 and a half hours. Then you got to look for another ride, the transit, for a couple hours, a few hours, if you're lucky, if it is not snowing. If it is snowing, you can just spend the night at the airport. Excuse me. Then you fly to either Texas, Florida, California, North Carolina, Atlanta, Georgia. So I've been flying around, mashallah, la quwwata illa billah. So sometimes within 10 days, I used to travel twice.
SubhanAllah.
Twice. But that also affected my health a lot. So I developed DVTs. And that's why I wasn't able to travel that often. So I slowed down and started taking care of my health.
I mean, I've seen you in quite a few countries now. We recently on Hajj together, subhanAllah.
Yeah.
I met you on the Hajj. But where was the first time we met? Can you remember?
That was in Africa.
Is it Nigeria?
I think the first time in Africa.
I think it was Nigeria, and then we had the journey of faith.
We were supposed to meet in the UK, but it didn't happen. Then we met in...
I'll tell you where it was. You remember I did the Hajj program a few years ago for Huda TV?
Yeah.
But we didn't meet
this time. We were there, but we never met. Yeah, I think it was either in Kenya or Nigeria.
Yeah.
We love Africa.
Yeah, Africa is nice.
Inshallah. Has great potentials.
Yeah.
The brothers and sisters in Africa are the easiest to give da'wah, mashallah.
Yeah. How was your experience in because you've been to Uganda, Kenya?
Well, again, it started as I was still living in the States, or my house in the States, going back and forth. And my community, my school, everything. Then once Ramadan, I saw there was a program on Al Majd channel. It was right before my live show or after. And the Majd in Arabic, they were hosting Dr. Abdurrahman Al-Sumait.
Oh, mashallah.
I was watching the program by myself. And I still remember what happened as I was watching this program in Ramadan before iftar, and the host was taking the cameraman and were going behind Dr. Abdurrahman Al-Sumait, showing his achievements in Africa. And John, I broke into tears.
Yeah.
Wallahi, I kept on crying and crying and crying nonstop.
Yeah.
And I said, this is the true da'wah. You know how it is in the States.
Yeah.
You know, five-star hotels and, you know, flying here and there. And after we finish, what are you going to die in? T-bone steak?
I don't know about this.
You know everything.
I don't know the five-star and the T-bone steaks.
So I said, man, this is the true da'wah. Yeah. This is the true da'wah.
Sheikh, I've been far in the jungle. Right, and you'll find a small masjid, and it's got the plaque of his charity.
I immediately decided to change my direction, or at least to give some attention to da'wah in Africa. Even though I didn't go to the same places like Dr. Abdurrahman Al-Sumait, and by the way, I was so blessed to visit him before he died.
Mashallah.
I always wanted to see this man who sacrificed his life. Or let me rephrase it, that Allah chose him for this kind of task. He's a nation by himself and his wife. Yeah. May Allah bless them both.
When I was living in Kuwait, I met Abdullah, his son. I know Abdullah.
It was his son who actually made it easy for me to see him in the hospital. You know, he was in the ICU and he was in his last few days. So I managed to see him before he died. May Allah have mercy on his soul. And I want to tell you that, you know, literally, the very person who inspired me to start traveling to Africa and considering giving da'wah in Africa, if we have achieved any success in Africa for the past 13 years, it is because of him. May Allah have mercy on his soul.
Ameen.
I think my first trip was to Uganda. It was a it was a debate.
Oh yeah.
We had like 7 Christian priests from various places, and mashallah, one of them accepted Islam. We had a lot of people accepted Islam on that day. It was in the stadium.
Yeah. The Ugandan people are very open to Islam, and they accept Islam with knowledge. Yeah.
You know, I wouldn't say Ugandans or Nigerians only.
There's some tribes which, you know, they're more difficult. They, you know, not all of them are so keen to accept. But Ugandans especially, they're very open to Islam, and they're very, because Muslims and Christians are living side by side.
And you know, Dr. Abdurrahman Sumit, he was a physician. And he studied also and graduated. His postgraduate degree was from Canada, I believe. So we decided to follow his footsteps. Myself and a few of my colleagues who are doctors, nephrologists, and internists or whatever, we decided to go to Africa and do, you know, in two parallel tracks, humanitarian help and da'wah.
MashaAllah.
I want to tell you this. I happen to stay in the in some of the finest hotels in the world and around the world, and fly in the finest airlines, and also I happen
and
to
swim in the finest swimming pools.
And I happen to stay in, as you said, the jungle, literally, and in some countries where the lifespan, the average lifespan, is only 50 years.
Yes.
Why? Because people don't have medication. You get renal failure, you get sick, you just die.
Yeah.
So we used to take the medication with us, and we would open free clinics and offer free treatment for everyone. Wallahi.
Subhanallah.
So the queue, they didn't have light. They didn't have clean drinking water. So we used to use the light, the flashlight on our phones until the battery would die. And the queue would be like miles. People are in lines and queues waiting for, you know, some analgesics or to know their blood pressure or whether they're diabetic or not. So one girl, she was a teenager, she came across and she said, "Oh, so doctor, do I have to become a Muslim in order to be treated?" She spoke very well English. And that made me shiver. Yeah. I said, "No, ma'am, you don't have to. You're absolutely free to take the medication and walk." We're not even given dawah then.
Yeah.
So we separated, you know, the humanitarian work, and that was out of our pocket.
Yeah.
I mean, we didn't have like a sponsorship. We didn't have a hotel to stay in. So myself and the doctors, we really slept on the floor. We were bitten by the mosquitoes badly.
Where was this actually? What country was this?
I don't know if I should say, but it's in Burundi.
Okay, mashallah.
It was such a long journey from here to there. And subhanallah, one day we were really starving. So we managed to get some fish. Okay. And we didn't know what to do with it because we don't have a stove. So we collected some fire logs and we just put the fish on the
Subhanallah.
It smells and everything, but it was very delicious.
You know, these type of experiences you value the most. You know, they're so much more valuable than staying in like a big 5-star hotel.
That's why
you remember them. And you remember the smells. You remember the smell of the fish, the cooking, everything, the fire. You know, it's
later on when I went to Connecticut, I was invited. And Ramadan, they asked me to visit them for a few days. This is what I can afford. And they booked me 5-star hotel. So because I came late when they checked me in and I saw the price, I phoned them immediately and said, "You know what? Let's take a hike. I'm not staying in this hotel." So where are you going to stay? I said, "I'm going to stay in the masjid." "No, no, no, you're going to stay in the masjid." I said, "Yes." And I bought a sleeping bag and I just slept in the masjid, and it was a beautiful experience. MashaAllah.
Sheikh, you know, people might be thinking, what you're doing here? You know, this isn't your back garden.
We're renting this place.
You know, just to clarify to the people at home, you know, we've been renting this place and we've just done a full series about the fiqh of love for Huda TV. And I just want to touch upon that before we, you know, before we have to go. Now, we've filmed 27 programs. 26.
You're counting when I pushed in your water?
Oh, no, I'm not counting.
As an episode?
SubhanAllah. So we've done 26 episodes on the fiqh of love.
Yes.
Because as you know, you mentioned, you know,
beginning from the first click, love at the first sight. You were mentioning all the way to divorce.
Yeah, from love at first sight all the way up to, you know, I don't want to see you again. You know, you're divorced. SubhanAllah, but this is a serious problem, right, Sheikh? Mm-hmm. You know, you get so many questions.
Well, I want to tell the viewers one thing. You were not as funny and as awake during the filming of the episode as now.
Sheikh, it's not easy, you know, because, you know, you've got your plan for the show and, you know, it's TV and the producers, they have
their
own.
You're under pressure.
Yeah, they have their own style and, you know, you have to sit up straight. Of course, this is my podcast, you know, okay. I can be more relaxed. You know, I'm the producer, you know, so, you know, but I thought it was a very beneficial thing. But Sheikh, you get so many questions about family and love and marriage. And why did you think it was so important? What?
One of those episodes a month ago on Ask Huda, subhanAllah, so many questions, one after another, from the UK, from Canada, from Holland, from the USA. They're all about marriage, divorce, mahr, iddah, custody of the children. My husband doesn't treat me well. So I suggested to the viewers and I said, you know what, I'd love to film a new program. And I'd like to call it Fiqh of Love. You know, it's just basically Fiqh of Marriage. And since Allah said in the ayah, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. So I took the name from there. But I didn't have the means, you know, to film something like that. You know, how many people behind the set? How many people?
What would you say, 20, 30?
30 people,
30 people, yeah.
Believe it or not.
SubhanAllah.
How many cameras are filming right now?
Five, six.
Not your seven. Little tiny 4K camera.
Yeah.
No, there are a lot of people here. Directors, yeah. Producers, lighting, crane man, cameraman.
Check, sorry. I my cameras are pretty good. You can't be digging my cameras.
I want to tell everyone
yeah.
who is behind the set right now, thank you.
Yeah, I want to thank the brothers as well, SubhanAllah.
May Allah bless you all. May Allah bless you all.
Yeah.
You've done a magnificent job.
Yeah.
We've been here for 5 days.
Yep.
MashaAllah.
And Sheikh, I have to say, look, you know, I've done TV work before, you know, not to throw anyone under the bus, but, you know, you have a great team, Sheikh.
Alhamdulillah.
You know, everyone's committed. Everyone's doing it.
What did you like most about them?
You know, everyone's in it for the dawah. Everyone feels like they're a part of it.
Whenever it's a prayer time.
Yeah, everyone's praying.
Yeah,
everyone's,
everybody's,
you know,
praying.
Any breaks, they're reciting Quran. You know, it reminds me of a famous incident, I think.
But when we break, you sing.
Yeah. But you know, when it reminds me of a famous incident, one of the presidents of America went to NASA and he seen the janitor, the cleaner. Hmm. He said, what do you do? And he says, I help people get to the moon.
Wow.
You know, subhanAllah. Yes. And that's how I feel with your team. You know, they might not be sat here actually giving the fatwa or speaking, but they're all a part of it. They're all getting the same reward.
That is absolutely true.
And subhanAllah, they really know that as well.
They know that. Yeah. You know, when we have Shahada live on air, everybody's celebrating and say the credit is for everyone. Everyone is sharing their work. Because without those 30 people, I wouldn't be sitting here.
Even though we're praising them so much, they're telling me to hurry up and get up. So Sheikh, I don't want to keep them so long because, you know, it's been a long week, subhanAllah.
Alhamdulillah.
And,
but it's a beautiful,
you know,
time.
But I just want to tell the viewers at home, please, you know, watch out for the Fiqh of Love. It was a great series. I really enjoyed it. And, you know, inshallah, maybe we can do another podcast in the future, Sheikh, and
inshallah.
Speak more about that.
May Allah make it easy.
Jazakallah khair, Sheikh.
Thank you so much.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi.
This is the time I've thought, yeah. Sheikh. Jazakallah khair.
Rana wa iyakum.
إنك لا تهدي من أحببت ولكن الله يهدي من يشاء.